ठीक है सर,
आराम से पढ़ा रहे हैं।
So after hearing about 1.5 hours or 1 hour of what India is doing and what are we doing right, probably coming to what we as mutual funds do right to ensure that you all make that extra return over and above the benchmarks or over and above the markets, and more importantly, how are we structured as mutual funds to manage your money more efficiently. The previous question on credits, and I'd just like to highlight the big difference between, say, Indian markets and some market like US. US is $20 trillion mutual fund market and a $5 trillion banking market. Effectively, it is telling you that mutual funds are more efficient, and that's why in US, mutual funds are 4 times the size of banking industry. In India, we are still 1/5, 100 lakh crore deposits, and we are only probably managing credits worth 5 lakh. So we can pick and choose. We have a natural advantage of picking and choosing. So probably for the next 10, 20 years, we don't have to worry too much about the defaults, etc., hitting us in a big way. And as already explained, and probably if I can cover that, I'll cover how the structures that we have in place ensure that both in equity and debt, the money is managed in a beautiful way. Of course, the current, I will restrict myself to equities because debt, Nilesh sir has already covered. And so essentially, when the money comes, this one slide actually can speak for itself for next half an hour and give you an insight as to what we do to manage your money. So like all institutions have structures, a mutual fund investment team also has a structure. And a mutual fund investment stream structure ensures that across all time periods, your money is managed in a beautiful way. The first part, which is probably not there, and that's where I started my career, and I was hired by none other than Mr. Nilesh Shah himself in ICICI about 13 years back. That's the dealing function. So dealers are essentially the ears and eyes of the organization, of the investment team. You sit in the dealing room morning 9:30 to 3:30 or morning 8 to 3:30 in the afternoon, and you essentially are the eyes. So whenever an event happens, the event has to get decimated to the analyst team or the fund management. That's the job which a dealing team does. The dealing team also has to ensure that the buying and selling of stocks, which happens, right? There are funds in which you invest, and those funds have to invest in stocks or divest from stocks. That is what the dealing team does. So it's a robust dealing team of 4 people that we have, and there may be 2 or 3 people in every AMC who do that. They basically take care of the buying and selling and acting as the eyes and ears of the entire investment team to ensure that your money is managed in a beautiful way. Then we come to the analyst team, right? There are different sectors in the market, and none of us can master all the sectors. There's telecom, there's IT, there's banking. So we as a mutual fund, and every mutual fund would have an analyst team, right? An analyst team, one single analyst may cover banking, one single analyst may cover telecom or IT. And then there are smaller sectors like chemicals, textiles, etc., which will be covered by a single analyst because they are relatively smaller in market. What do the analysts do, right? That's where the specialization comes in. That's why they say expert opinion is important in everything. When we have a headache, we can easily take a paracetamol and probably take care of it. But when it becomes that much more complicated, and equity markets, as was explained in the last 1 hour, are extremely complicated. It's very difficult for a layman to understand what's going to happen when, and that's where the analyst team or the entire structure helps. One analyst covers one sector. I used to cover oil and gas between 2010 and 2015. So for my job was very simple. Between Reliance, ONGC, IOC, HP, BP, Petronet, LNG, GAIL, which is the best stock that a mutual fund should own? Which price it should own at, which price it should sell at? And that's the edge which an analyst brings. How does that analyst essentially run, or how does the analyst give his recommendations? It's very simple. We as an analyst team go and meet the companies. You as investors can read the balance sheet, but probably you may not have access to meet the companies. So we meet the companies, we meet the competitors. We go and basically visit the factories as well. I have visited Reliance factory, and I visited SR factory also, SR Oil. And once you do that, or refining, which is there in Jamnagar, once you do that, you come to know which is a better company, which is better managed, because you get to meet people on the ground, right? You get to meet the actual people who are working on the ground. And that also ensures that if there is a company which does not have a real business, you can weed out that company immediately. So we have the natural edge of meeting those companies. Those companies are in their own interest that we as a mutual fund should buy their shares, because any company which is bought by a mutual fund, there is a recognition that comes to that company in that sense, that it's a listed company bought by a mutual fund. There is respect that that company gets. And hence, they come and will explain to us, this is our business. Because we have access to companies, analysts, experts ourselves, you know, industry experts, we are able to figure out which company is better, which company is not. And most importantly, because we have valuation as one of the focuses, we are able to figure out which company to buy at what prices. So that's the basic role of an analyst, to basically recommend which stock to buy and when. How does the analyst do that? And how does the analyst communicate? Because the role of the analyst is to communicate to the fund manager, right? Because the fund manager is managing the funds, and the analyst is essentially just picking up the stock and mentioning whether it should be bought or sold. So there is a way of communicating between analyst and fund manager. And that way, at least in ICICI Pru, we have model portfolios. What is a model portfolio? A model portfolio is essentially a portfolio which the analyst team runs, which communicates to the fund manager that, hey, this is a banking sector and this is the oil and gas sector. Within the banking sector, I like, say, HDFC Bank over a State Bank of India because HDFC Bank has a better growth potential. That's the job of the analyst team. And every month in the beginning of the first week, this meeting is held by the analysts and all the sectors are put together. This is just a snapshot of one of the meetings. When if you see, it is a very objective way of communication. There is no subjectivity involved. Whether the analyst, if you look at Nifty weight is 5.7, and the recommended weight is, say, 7 in ICICI Bank, which essentially meant that at that point of time, the analyst was positive ICICI Bank. If you see in probably SBI, the weight is 2.81, the recommended weight is 4. At that point of time, he was overweight SBI. So this is one of the ways of communication between analyst team and fund management team. Because in our history in the last 15 years that I have been part of the investment team, we've seen times when the communication between fund manager and analyst team becomes the most important tool. If there's a breakdown in communication or if there's a miscommunication, it can cause a severe problem. So one is the analyst, second is the fund manager. What is the role of a fund manager? And while it may seem a role which is, say, Monday to Friday, it's actually not a Monday to Friday role when markets are on. It's a Sunday to Sunday, 365 days a year. There is no choice for fund managers but to be aware of what's happening, not just locally but globally. How do they manage your funds? There are different kinds of funds within equity, right? Large cap fund, mid cap fund, etc. So as a fund manager, the first job that I have is to ensure that the portfolio which I have, what are the boundaries of that portfolio? You all may be aware that there are large cap funds. So in that large cap fund, I can only take, say, 1 to 100 stocks. So that becomes my job as fund manager, that I pick the stocks which I'm supposed to pick within the boundary of that fund. Second is, I have to ensure that whatever is my analyst team's recommendation, with my own personal experience, typically fund managers have more experience than analyst team, with my own experience, can I add value over and above what the analyst is saying and make a portfolio which will ultimately deliver more return to the investors? And how is the portfolio construction done? The portfolio construction is done essentially by ensuring that there's a good sectoral mix, all the sectors are represented properly. And once the sectors are represented properly, within each sector, what do I pick? There are a few slides which will come in on a stock specific, which will probably explain that. But as a fund manager, my role is very simple. Yet it is very complicated. The simplicity is stick to the boundaries. The complication is which stock should I pick? When should I pick up the stock? Is there enough liquidity? As the size of the fund increases, I have to probably be early. So all such permutations, combinations, and that's where the fund manager's role becomes complicated and challenging as well. And it is our belief that the synchronization between the analyst team and the fund management team, if it is better, it basically shows that the mutual fund will, over long periods of time, create alpha. Now the question on alpha itself, what creates alpha? Essentially, for a fund manager, the alpha creation process is fourfold. One is stock selection itself. And there they are aided by analysts, but they have their own inputs also. Each fund manager has their own experiences. So when you have a stock selection, right, which stock to pick becomes important, which stock not to pick also becomes important, right? What to do, what not to do also applies in a stock selection process. And over a period of time, with experience, fund managers know what to pick, what not to pick. So if and what helps the fund managers and analysts doing that, both have to do that, is annual reports. Reading of annual reports, becomes extremely important. Reading of quarterly results becomes extremely important. There was a discussion on one of the companies like Satyam. And if you see, if the annual report you would have seen, we as a mutual fund at that point of time had very limited exposure to Satyam despite it being a Nifty 50 stock. And the reason for that was very simple. If you picked up Satyam's annual report, it was a company which said that it had 8,000 crores of cash on books. That 8,000 crore cash on books in a country like India, which has probably 6 to 7% interest rate at all points of time, should have reflected at least 400 to 500 crores of interest income. Satyam used to not report interest income more than 150 crores, maybe less than 100 crores. So the balance sheet itself, if you had read properly, you would know that there is some problem. And hence, we never had a very big exposure. So those are the small instances where you can figure out that whether the company is good or bad by reading the balance sheet or the annual report. It's a very, very specific thing which analysts are tuned to do. As chartered accountants, of course, we are told what an annual report or what a balance sheet should look like, what are the ratios which are there. As individual investors, you may not be equipped to do that. You may not have the time to do that also. But every company which we have about 350 companies under our coverage. Those 350 companies, we have about 10 analysts to 12 analysts to cover 30 companies each. Their job is to go through each quarterly report, through each annual report. And if there are annual reports, and this is the annual report season between July, August, and September, October, if there are any red flags, immediately point out. Does that mean that we don't make mistakes? Of course, out of probably 150 or 200 companies in the mid and small cap space, because of the nature of probably reporting not being good, there may be some instances of problems which we will face. But en masse, in general, our job is that out of the 1,500 listed companies in India which are investable universe, probably the 300, 350 which are cleanest, we cling on to them. And in general, over a long period of time, that is what makes money. Where we end up losing money, or where a normal investor ends up losing money, is investing in companies which actually don't have a business model, and then the stock prices fall sharply. We try to avoid that by having the right stock selection. Second is sector rotation. What do you mean by sector rotation? Sector rotation is a very simple thing. In 2008, telecom companies in India were doing very well. Their market caps were extremely high because their balance sheets were much cleaner. And if you see the rise of, say, Bharti Telecom between 2004-05 and 2008, it was massive. Then their balance sheet started deteriorating. If you held on to telecom for the last 10 years, that's not made any money for you. So it becomes very important to know exactly which sector to be in where. And there again, the fund manager's own experience along with the support of the investment team and analyst team helps a lot. The model portfolio, which I showed you earlier, essentially also becomes a good indicator. Because in the model portfolio, if you see, there is banking, there is telecom, there is oil and gas, etc. If an analyst thinks that his sector is extremely cheap, he may go extremely overweight that sector. That also gives an indication for the fund manager that sector is something which is likely to do well. Think about it 1 year back, 1.5 years back, when IT, that is information technology, even before this rupee depreciation. Actually, if you go back February 2017 or Jan 2017, information technology, which typically are very clean balance sheets, clean companies in terms of cash flow, they were available at 10 to 12 times, maybe some of them were available at 14 times P, while market was at more than 20 to 23 times P. If you invested in the technology sector, if you went overweight in the technology sector, you would have ended up making 50% return in the last 1.5 years. So sector rotation becomes extremely important part of fund management, and that if you actually see each portfolio in the fund manager in his own way, keeps on moving between sectors in a manner that generates higher return. Can you do that as an individual very successfully? The answer is no, because the span of sectors is wide. We have about 10 to 12 large sectors in India. India is not a one-trick pony. India is not like Indonesia, where coal becomes extremely big, or like Australia, where again iron ore is very big, or metals are very big, like Korea, where Samsung is very big. India is basically all different types of sectors, and that's what makes India a very good destination for foreigners to invest in, and that's what makes it easier for us as fund managers also to allocate between different sectors. So that's on sector rotation. We have to do sector rotation because each sector has its own cycles. There was a time when oil marketing companies like HP, BP, IOC in 2013-14 were available at a significant discount. They gave a 7, 8, 9 bagger return. That happened because that time everything was negative. And what was spoken about being contra applies a lot on sector and applies a lot on fund management in general. Your investment should be contrarian, and also the sectoral choices at times helps if it is contrarian, right? If you follow the trend, you may not make the best of money, you may end up losing. Hence, investing or managing funds is also like driving a car looking ahead. If we drive a car, looking at the rearview mirror, there is always a chance of a crash. There is always a chance that you will do wrong. Hence, investing also is very important. Don't invest looking at past returns. Don't invest in a sector which has already done well. If you see the last five or six cycles that India has had, 1995, 2000. In 2000, if you invested in IT, you would have had a problem. In infrastructure, 2008, you would have a problem. And probably in 2008, the entire NBFC space in general, which has got overvalued, if you invest in them, there may be a problem. So today also FMCG, for example, FMCG stocks are probably trading at 60, 70 times. If you are invested in that, there is a problem. So what do we do as mutual funds, or what do we do as fund managers? We stay away from the expensive stocks. We are happy to lose out on the last 10, 20, 30, 40%. Because when the rise happens, it's fine. When the fall happens, there are no takers. We try and avoid the fall, and that itself gives you the alpha. By avoiding the expensive stocks, by being in stocks which are value, over a period of 3 to 5 years, we tend to generate alpha for you. Hence, when you invest in a mutual fund, when you invest in a mutual fund, don't look at a mutual fund return over 1 year, 2 years. Give it at least 5 years, I would say. Ideally, give it 10 years, 20 years. You will get the benefit of compounding, as was mentioned earlier. If you invest in shorter periods of time, it becomes a difficult task. Because when you invest in a mutual fund, you are investing in an equity mutual fund, you are actually becoming a business owner. And typically, we don't sell our businesses and buy businesses every day, right? We invest in business, or our business we run for decades and pass it on to generations. If you do that with mutual funds also, it will be probably something which you will do, which will benefit the generations ahead in terms of the compounding growth that India has to offer. On the sectoral rotation part, again, one of the important tools of alpha generation. Alpha is essentially the return, extra return that we generate for you over the benchmark. Asset allocation is again a very important thing, and that's where the entire category of dynamic asset allocation has become extremely big, the balanced advantage funds. And I dare say that that category has a potential of 5 lakh crore to 10 lakh crore in terms of AUM. Today it has only 50,000 crores. So what is asset allocation? It is said that 87% of the wealth that we create is through asset allocation. Whether we've been real estate in 2003, get out of real estate in 2013, invest in equities in 2013, probably get out of equities or reduce equity exposure over next 2, 3, 4 years when equities become extremely expensive, and move back to real estate or something, some other asset class which is extremely cheap. Moving between asset class obviously requires expert advice, and that's where a financial advisor becomes extremely important in everyone's life, the same way as a family doctor is important. And asset allocation in the right way. In this case, the asset allocation products which we in mutual funds have are essentially moving between debt and equity. Currently, if we see, because the markets are where they are, the asset allocation products will have less equity. But in 2013, when markets were very cheap, the asset allocation products will increase your equity exposure significantly, maybe 80%, maybe 100%. So asset allocation is another tool. Being in the right asset class at the right time, buying low, selling high, it becomes extremely important. And in terms of timing, which stock to buy when, which stock to not buy, which stock to sell, it becomes very important. While buying can be valuation-based, selling is an art. Not many people can know exactly when to sell what, and that's where it becomes extremely important that expertise is there in terms of selling. Now I'll come to the stock examples. When I said that, what do we do in terms of stock selection? What makes basically stock selection very important? If you see this 2012 to 2015, it's a dated example. Just by being in Kotak and avoiding SBI, you would have been able to generate that much extra return. And that's what we as fund managers do in our funds. This is exactly what we did in one of our large cap funds, which is Blue Chip Fund, which has been one of our flagship funds, one of the largest funds that we have. Second is avoiding the sector which is expensive, being in sector which is cheap. 2010, after the infrastructure boom, if you would have avoided infrastructure and invested in pharma stocks, that's exactly what we did in our dynamic fund, which is now called multi-asset fund, you can get the advantage of the 2010 to 2015 pharmaceutical boom. And why was that? Because infrastructure stocks at that time were quoting at 30p, 40p, they were expensive. While pharmaceutical stocks, which have better balance sheets, were quoting at 12 or 13 times. So just by moving between staying away from expensive sectors, being into cheaper sectors, you have a situation wherein your money can actually compound without losing. Because if you were invested in infrastructure, and many of you, if you have invested in 2007 in infrastructure, your return experience hasn't been that great. So essentially, if we see, as fund managers, what do we bring on the table? One is obviously in-depth analysis of the stocks through balance sheet analysis, through quarterly result report, through meeting the funds, through meeting the investors, through meeting the companies, through meeting various other sectoral experts to figure out. And we have an entire ecosystem of analysts who are experts in their field, right? If you do something for maybe 4 years, 5 years, 6 years, you become such an expert that you will know that, okay, X company is better than Y. And that is what we bring on the table as an institution, as an investment fund house. And that also helps us in terms of ensuring that we take the right calls at the right time. Because we have a team which studies macroeconomics as well as underlying stocks, we are able to give good calls on the various markets also, where in markets you should invest. So when 2012 CAD was worsening, you could have invested in export-oriented stocks. That's what, again, as a recommendation, if we give export-oriented in 2012, you would know. We launched the US Blue Chip Fund, which was investing in US Blue Chip. It adds to your returns. When currently in the last 1.5 year, the only thing which we've been mentioning is that reduce the mid-cap and small-cap allocation which you have. If you see in the last 6 months, mid-cap and small-cap index, small-cap index has fallen 20%. So just by being away from mid and small-cap, your portfolios would have benefited. If someone stayed in mid and small-cap, it was something which would have caused problems. So essentially, as an investment house, as a fund house, how we manage your money, what kind of recommendations give, the entire package is based on the strong team which we have, which has probably a mix of everyone, chartered accountants, engineers, to basically give a blend and understanding of whatever the sectors are, and we try and give you that return. And our goal is very simple. Our goal is to not give the maximum return to you, because in taking the maximum return, we can take maximum risk, which can affect you in a shorter span of time. In the long run, if we are able to generate consistently alpha for you, which is through better stock selection, through good processes, it's something which will do well for your investors. So on an overall basis, it's a very simple thing. The structure is there, the dealing team is there, the investment, the analyst team is there, the fund management team is there. Then there is a CIO who basically overlooks this entire process, who sees whether all the funds are managed in the right manner or not. So it's an institution. Investment team is like the heart of any AMC. And with many years of experience, the stronger the experience and the stronger the investment team, the better is your return experience. This is in nutshell how the money is managed. As such, each of these topics can actually take long, but since it's the interest of time, I'll open up for questions if there are any, and then probably allow the next speaker to continue with the discussion on behavioral finance, which should be very interesting, and then there's a discussion on debt, I think. Yes, sir.
Technology. I need to understand in this particular domain how the technology is giving the leverage so that we will have the less dependency on the human and that machine can take the decision based upon my requirement. There are some parameters, see my risk appetite, my investment, what are the different, it should be integrated with the different industries and based upon that machine can give the some insight so that people will be able to invest.
So globally, artificial intelligence powered funds are growing significantly. The one major difference between one major difference between India and globe is the quality of data, one, availability, and second is that because in India the dynamics change so frequently between, say, companies, the growth are different, it's not a steady state. So for an artificial intelligence or robotic to suddenly predict to perfection may not be easy because of the rules and regulations also change. However, if there are permutations, combinations or robotics or artificial intelligence which can take all of this into account and give you the right output, it's something which is happening in the globe, it can repeat in India also. But considering that India is a country where there is 1,500 companies, you already have an established system of funds which are being managed, the costs in India are also not high, probably in the next 10 years, this will not pick up significantly. However, there are artificial intelligence powered engines which tell you which mutual fund to buy, not buy, but then we don't know because those are all probably looking at past parameters. And if a mutual fund changes, whether they're able to change their engine is something which we need to figure out. So yes, there is scope, but I'd say that over the next 10 years, when data in India improves significantly, when the country matures and the companies mature, when the rules and regulations are stable, that is the time when a predefined or artificial intelligence, which actually has also learning capabilities, will do well. As of now, in our own system of things, it is totally driven by individual who are actually seeing the markets, are doing the research. It is not, we don't have any AI powered right now, but it is something where we keep getting inputs or we keep getting people who are doing that to come and showcase to us that, okay, this is what we are doing. Can it help you in your fund management? At some point of time, probably we will incorporate that, but as of now, that's not the case.
Whether you have any insight, you can say is a case studies or the use cases where if you see in maybe in the Europe or the US, people have just used the AI or maybe the artificial intelligence,
if you actually,
where it has given the right results so that people will get more and more confidence.
No, so if you see, if you guys Google it, you will find in US the AI powered stock picker or stock picking funds are also coming up. There is AI powered ETFs also which are coming up. Very small as a percentage of the $20 trillion, but they are coming up. If you just Google, you'll come to know. I don't have any specific insight, but there are AI powered in S&P was telling me that S&P Global has they have a database, right? And they have come across AI powered ETFs also, which basically underlying changes. It's a listed entity, but the underlying changes based on purely AI. How successful they are, probably they are too new to figure out. And typically AI, if it's following momentum, it may be successful in the short run. The longer tenure, we'll have to see.
For a, excuse me?
Yes, sir.
For a relative passive investor.
Yes.
The passive investor is anyway going for mutual funds because he's passively investing.
Correct.
Is there a ground rule analysis structure you can give how to evaluate between the different funds, or different mutual funds, because he's passive, he's confused. So if there's a ground rule definition, this is how you go through and make an informed decision?
See, it's like investments is a very specific thing. It's like how medicines have different ingredients and chemicals, and we as laymen may not come to know. We need an expert advice. That's where I think if you want to yourself do it, then you may need to learn a lot about individual companies, sectors, then you'll be able to differentiate between. So you may have certain websites which will tell you these are the better funds, etc. But then within those funds, which one is suited for you, which stocks are underlying, which sectors are underlying, again, you'll need a little bit more insight into that. If you ask me, a simple way to do it is you see the consistency which the fund has performed for the last 10 years, 15 years, right? That data is available on many of the websites in terms of 1 year, 3 year, 5 year, 7 year. Don't go by just 1 year data, because that 1 year or 3 year can actually be a flash in the pan. A fund manager's history becomes extremely important. How long the fund manager has managed that particular fund, and in general, has the fund manager seen cycles? Or has that investment house seen cycles? And in different cycles, what has that investment house done? One thing is the current performance of 1 year and 3 year. How has that current performance come? When a person or when a financial advisor will do his due diligence and recommend you the fund, he will do all this. He will tell you, this is the history of that fund manager. This is how they manage the fund, because they probably go and meet the fund managers also, right? The large finance fund, large financial advisor, they go and meet the fund manager. So they know exactly that in the last 1 year, he stayed away from FMCG and he invested in oil and gas stocks, which were cheaper. Utilities which were cheaper, and that is why probably he's underperforming right now. But when the market rationalizes, you will see if FMCG stocks fall, you will find this value coming out. Exactly the pharma versus infrastructure. In 2008-09 or 2007-08 specifically, or 7, all that everyone was investing in was infra. In fact, our own infra fund then was 50% of our AUM, because that's where people wanted to put all the money. And for 10 years then returns have not been made. So essentially, is it easy for you as an individual to pick up a fund? The answer is no. But I'll tell you, what is easy in terms of wealth creation is doing SIP since the time you start a job, and then if you have children, doing SIPs in your children's name or your grandchildren's name and letting it run for the rest of your life is a sure shot way of making wealth. There you don't have to bother about funds or the fund house. In general, if you do it in a multi-cap fund or a large cap fund, okay, you're fine. But that's an easy way to do SIP. That's the way to invest in a manner where you are not bothered about anything. Just do systematic investment over next 10 years, 20 years, you'll make money. But individually to pick funds means you'll have to have the knowledge of the companies, and as a passive investor, you'll not. That's why it helps to have an advisor who can advise you on that. It saves you the effort and it will probably give you more return, which will justify the cost that that you bear on account of having a financial advisor also. We need a chartered accountant for our tax, etc., right? That chartered accountant brings a certain expertise. Similarly, a financial advisor brings a certain expertise, even if you have to pay. As long as you believe the financial advisor is adding a lot more value, it makes sense to have a financial advisor. Otherwise, you want to do it yourself, just see the consistency, just see the long-term track record in terms of the performance, and try and see the portfolio. In that case, stick to large cap oriented and probably the better known names in terms of the fund houses that you generally hear. But it is not easy to do it yourself. Again, I would say that would be the answer. It's not easy. Even I would find it difficult if I had to rate without being in the industry. Today I've spent 13 years, so it becomes easier. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I have a more topical question in the sense that a few days ago we've been told that ILFS, whatever is happening there, is not systemic. Is not important for the system as a whole. But something, a rumor sets off DHFL and everything goes tumbling down. What's happening there? That is one. And second, which are the three sectors that you think are now on the up move in the sector allocation, and which are the three sectors which are going down now? So they'll help us a little more,
sure.
Maybe.
Sure.
Thanks.
So in terms of the contagion effect of an ILNFS or DHFL. See, financial leveraged entities are always something which, when the markets are going to turn or become extremely expensive, one or the other kind of falls. And to answer your question, can a rumor spark something which is big? It is unlikely. When something falls 40-50%, there is always a concrete reason behind that. I have not seen in my living lifetime of 13 years in the industry since October 2005, something going off other than it being a systemic, meaning 2008 October, my apologies, when Lehman collapsed, it was systemic. Then there, the best and the worst, everything fell because markets fell 27%. But when there is an out of whack fall in a particular stock, there is a certain tangible reason behind it. Now, that tangible reason, will it be something which we'll know today or maybe after a month or after two, we don't know. And in financial leverage entities, you'll always find, not just in India, abroad as well, these things coming up. You have to be aware. You have to be aware. There, the credit rating agency or otherwise a AAA does not have any meaning. There can be a temporary mismatch. So what is happening right now is probably interest rates have gone up. Liquidity has tightened significantly. These funds were probably borrowing at 1 year and lending for 3 years, 5 years, 10 years. And they probably lent to builders, real estate developers who are not able to lend back. Maybe they have the assets, but no current liquidity. So it's a mismatch. It's called the asset liability mismatch, ALM. And that was causing a problem for many of these housing finance companies or in general the NBFC space. And it can actually have a ballooning effect if the liquidity tightens further in the next 3 months, 6 months. So I would, and in general, yesterday whatever happened, but in the last whatever 2 months, 3 months that we've been discussing, we're basically highlighting the NBFC is a risky space in general also, because we were basically having lower interest rates in India, easy liquidity, especially after demonetization, when so much money went into the banking system. That banking system money through NBFC, banks were not lending. But NBFCs were lending either personal loans or housing finance loans or X or Y or Z, loan against property, real estate, etc. Banks cannot lend to land. Banks cannot lend for land. NBFCs can. So it's a conduit way wherein NBFCs became a face. And that's the worry which I have in general of it being a contagion. Should we or you worry as an investor? Yes, you should worry. But that's where the funds which you are owning, how much exposure do they have to banks, be it debt funds or equity funds? That is something which you should ask your financial advisor to evaluate for you and then take the necessary precautionary steps to ensure that if there is a contagion which goes out of hand, at least you are safe for surviving the carnage which may happen.
I would
you had one more question. Yeah, okay. Three sectors which we like, three sectors which we don't like. So today, clearly the sector which is not to be touched is FMCG in general. unless you have a 20-year view. I wouldn't even say 10-year view, and I'll say why. Because something like a Hindustan Unilever for 10 years between 2003 and 2013 remained at 160 rupees. 2013-14 from 160, it has gone up to 1700. Is it a good company? There is no doubt about it. But is it priced for perfection? The answer is yes. So maybe the next 5-year, 10-year return may not be that great. And that is true for maybe an Asian Paints, Hindustan Unilever, all the expensive names which have got too expensive, Pidilite, Marico, etc. They are great companies. I'm just going by past history. In the year 2000, Infosys went from 2% to 13% of Nifty in the year 2000. Fund managers who had Infosys, they became gods. Fund managers who did not have Infosys were crying. That's exactly what is happening today also. If you have Hindustan Unilever, TCS, Reliance, Bajaj Finserv, Bajaj Finance, you're fine. If you don't have them, you're crying. And that's where probably many of you would be finding your funds are not performing in line with the markets. But what happened after the year 2000 where Infosys went from 2 to 13% of Nifty? Obviously, it became extremely overvalued. And it was one of the most expensive stocks then. For the next 3 years, it fell 30%, 30%, 30%. I'm not saying that these stocks will fall 30, 30, 30, because Infosys was extremely overvalued then. I think it must have gone to 200 P150. That price of Infosys took 10, 12, 15 years to come, despite Infosys growing every year at 30%. So the overvaluation in markets can sometimes take stocks to such a stratospherical level that even the best of stock may not give you that much return. And I think even today, Wipro has not touched its all-time high, which it had in 2000 or 1999-2000. So these are great companies. Even HLL is a great company. But that's where FMCG is something which I will be worried about. NBFCs as a space, irrespective of what happened yesterday, that's a space which we have under-owned in our mutual funds. We don't have the NBFC exposure in a large way. So wherever we find discomfort, we don't have it. And NBFCs and FMCG, we are underweight. In FMCG, probably ITC is the only company which can at least fit in because it's at 30p. It's a sin stock, no doubt, but that's the only way. So FMCG and NBFCs, those are the two sectors which are clear no. I don't have a third sector where I have a clear no today, unfortunately. On the positive side, I think the entire PSU pack, even though the general connotation is or notion is that PSUs don't make money and etc., I am of the firm belief that PSUs from year till June 2019 can actually give you good return experience, at least the ones which have a good balance sheet. There is always an uptick of buybacks also. If you just Google it, 1 week back, the Honorable Finance Minister gave a go-ahead for 13 companies to do buyback. And I deal with the Department of Investment and Public Asset Management here in Delhi a lot, courtesy our Bharat 22 ETF. And we also obviously push them, right, that these companies have become extremely cheap. Why don't you do that? So it flows from there, then there, and it comes. So there's a buyback which is there in 13 companies which can aid. And secondly, many of these companies have become extremely cheap. Namely, if I say NTPC, can all of us live without electricity? The answer is no. And today, other than NTPC, there is no other power company which is going to grow. Adani ho, Tata ho, ya Reliance Infra, they all have their own problems. So NTPC becomes a default choice for power. So that's how NTPC is one of the largest ownership which we have in our funds in terms of the overweights, let's say. Second is ONGC. In 13 years, and having covered oil and gas for 5 years, I have not seen ONGC as cheap as it is today, right? Now, again, all the disclaimers which Nilesh Bhai mentioned, I'll also have those disclaimers. I'm not going to put them up, but these are things which we believe in, and you can find them in our funds. 6.5 times on current earnings, ONGC has not been that cheap. IOC and HPCL, again, they've fallen 50%. Irrespective of what happens, Iran oil not coming, their profitability going down, they are cheap on asset value basis. And the entire defense PSU pack, right? Bharat Electronics gone down from 193 to 80. What I'm trying to say is there are enough in the oil and gas or the public sector space which is cheap, and you will find value in many of them. I can think of many companies, NNDC, NALCO, many companies which are extremely cheap, Engineers India, NHPC. The list is endless. Second favored sector, I would say, is, which may take maybe 3-4 years, and there's only one company in that, honestly, it is telecom. It is a 5-year story, 10-year story. Many of us don't believe that telecom will give us returns. But my belief is that none of us can live without our mobile phones. And now from 20 companies, there are only 3 companies which are there in telecom. If you just go by the rule of three, there is going to be price hikes in telecom, and even a 20%, 30% price hike. Today I'm paying 150 rupees for my Jio connection, right? I have a Vodafone, but I use Jio. That 150, it goes to 250. And that Bharti also is able to get that much, Bharti becomes extremely profitable. And Idea breaks even probably. So I'm saying that we are paying lowest for data today in the entire world, probably 1/10 of what the world is paying, 1/100 of what the world is paying. You go to Dubai, Gulf, US, it's very expensive. Data is expensive than in India. So telecom becomes a longer term data, not immediately. That's on telecom. Otherwise, IT, pharma. I think all of you should have a systematic investment plan in any of the pharma. Pharmaceutical oriented, we have a PhD, but pharmaceutical oriented funds, because with the way the cost of escalation will happen in hospitals, etc., and pharmaceuticals, you may want to invest and remain invested. That's a good way to beat the inflation in pharmaceuticals. So having a SIP in a pharmaceutical sector, typically no one recommends sectoral funds to you in general, right? It's you invest now, remove. But pharmaceutical is one space where you keep doing SIP, you are fine. So that would be the third, pharmaceutical and IT for the next 1 year, if you ask me, because of the tailwind of the rupee. So these are the ones, and in general, many of the Indian manufacturers will do well. So manufacturing as a theme, we have an NFO also coming up, which will not have banking. But there are brick and mortar businesses like Bajaj Auto, Hero Honda, etc., which are available at reasonable prices. I'm not saying that good balance sheets. Those are the sectors which we'll look at. I will not look at leverage entities because of interest rates rising. I'll not look at companies which have a bad balance sheet, and if you are a leader in your own space, buy. But in general, above 40p, don't buy. That's general.
Members of audience are requested to please put forth any questions in the break.
What is your opinion about auto industry in India?
Okay, may I answer that?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So, auto industry. Auto industry is shown in the first slide itself, right? Maruti, one of the best. And Maruti is 50% of India's 30 lakh cars that we sell. We sell 30 lakh cars. Maruti is 54% out of that. just put it in perspective, and I'll end it in 2 minutes.
Yes.
Just give me 2 minutes. India is a population of 130 crores. China is 150 crores roughly. We sell 30 lakh cars. China sells 3 crore cars. Will we go from 30 lakh cars to 1 crore cars? The answer is yes. Will Maruti have a 50% market share? Almost certainly it will have. So Maruti, while it has gone up 8 times in the last 3 years, and probably as it was shown 44 times since it got divested, it still remains a pole position as far as auto industry is concerned. If you ask me, sir, there is one set of industries in India where there is clearly an edge. Auto is one of them, auto ancillary, because autos are doing well. 30 lakh cars going to 1 crore cars in the next 4 years. So Maruti is putting up a 9,000 crore plant in Manesar, not very far from the other side, because it's a 7.5 lakh car capacity which they are putting up. Because they are seeing in the next 4 years, India will sell 50 lakh cars. Now, many of you will have this question, where are the roads? I also don't have that answer, that there may not be roads in Delhi, Bombay, Bangalore, and Hyderabad. And I've been in these four cities in the last 8 days, Delhi, Bombay, Bangalore, and Hyderabad, and I know the traffic is bad. But tier 2, tier 3, even the villages have roads. So auto sector, positive. Some of the companies may not give you immediate return because they've gone up a lot. But in terms of their balance sheet, cash flow, they are very good. If we've grown from 50 lakh two-wheeler sales to 2 crore two-wheeler sales in the last 10 years. We will grow from 2 crore to maybe 4 crore in the next 10 years. It's general progression. If China is selling 3 crore cars at some point of time from 30 lakh, we will go to 1 crore. I'm extremely bullish. And the good part about India is we are the fourth largest country in terms of auto sales. We will grow higher. We have the land, labor. We also have the capability. We have the auto companies which are doing that. We will become probably an export hub also. So auto is an extremely good space with good companies, and they are probably duopolies or triopolies. So it's easy to play in the market also.